Good morning, class 7. Today we will start chapter 4 of your history book, The Mughal Empire. Till now we have talked about the Sultanate period. Today we will begin with the Mughal Empire. Ruling as large a territory as the Indian subcontinent with such a diversity of people and cultures was an extremely difficult task for any ruler to accomplish in the Middle Ages. Quite in contrast to their predecessors, the Mughals created an empire and accomplished what had hitherto seemed possible for only short periods of time. From the latter half of the 16th century, they expanded their kingdom from Agra and Delhi until in the 17th century they controlled nearly all of the subcontinent. They imposed structures of administration and ideas of governance that outlasted their rule, leaving a political legacy that succeeding rulers of the subcontinent could not ignore. So obviously, when you talk about the Mughal Empire, they have ruled our country for quite a long time. That is from 1526 till the Britishers were here, and the last Mughal ruler was Mahabahadur Shah Zafar, who was sent to Rangoon, right? So that was a long duration. But if you talk about the powerful ruler, so the last powerful ruler of the Mughal Empire was Aurangzeb. The later Mughals after him, they were comparatively weak. So today the Prime Minister of India addresses the nation on Independence Day from the ramparts of Red Fort in Delhi, the residence of the Mughal emperors. Who were the Mughals? The Mughals were descendants of two great lineages of rulers. From their mother's side, they were descendants of Genghis Khan, who died in 1227, the Mongol ruler who ruled over parts of China and Central Asia. From their father's side, they were the successors of Timur, who died in 1404, the ruler of Iran, Iraq, and modern-day Turkey. So they were from, when you talk about the Mughals, they were descendants of Genghis Khan from one side, and who was a Mongol ruler, and from the mother's side. And from the father's side, they were successor of Timur. Timur Lung, that because he was little, when he used to walk, he limped. This was because Genghis Khan's memory was associated with the massacre of innumerable people. So Mughals did not like to be called as Mughal or Mongol. The reason was because people remember Genghis Khan as a person who caused huge massacre. So therefore they didn't like them to be referred as Mongols or Mughals. It was also linked with the Uzbeks, their Mongol competitor. On the other hand, Mughals were proud of their Timurid ancestry, not least of all because their great ancestor had captured Delhi in 1398. So they felt proud when they talked about their lineage with Timur, because Timur was the one who attacked and conquered India in 1398. They celebrated their genealogy pictorically, each ruler getting a picture made of Timur and himself. Take a look at figure 2, which is somewhat like a group photograph. So you can see figure 2, which is like a group photograph, and we can see which is a miniature painting which dated to 1702 to 1712 of Timur, his descendants, and the Mughal emperor. Timur is in the center, and on his right is his son Mira Shah, the first Mughal emperor, Babur's great-great-grandfather, and then Abu Sayyid, Babur's great-grandfather. To the left of Timur, Sultan Muhammad Mirza, Babur's great-grandfather, and Umar Sheikh, Babur's own father. The Mughal emperor Babur, Akbar, and Shah Jahan are the third, fourth, and fifth individuals on Timur's right and his left. In the same order are Humayun, Jahangir, and Aurangzeb. So you can see that all the emperors, popular ones, from the Mughal Empire have been presented in this painting. Now, Mughal military campaigns. Babur, the first Mughal emperor, 1526 to 1530, succeeded to the throne of Fergana in 1494 when he was only 12 years old. He was forced to leave his ancestral throne due to the invasion of another Mongol group, the Uzbeks. After a year of wandering, he seized Kabul in 1504. In 1526, he defeated the Sultan of Delhi, Ibrahim Lodi, at Panipat and captured Delhi and Agra. So Babur, who was the first Mughal emperor to set up his empire in our country in 1526, and he was the ruler till 1530. He succeeded to the throne of Fergana in 1494 when he was 12 years old. But then he was forced to leave his ancestral throne due to the invasion from the Mongol group. That was the Uzbeks. They have invaded and therefore he had to leave the place where he was born. Table 1 chart some of the major campaigns of Mughals. Study it carefully and see if you can notice any long-term patterns. You will notice, for example, that the Afghans were an immediate threat to Mughal authority. Note the relationship between the Mughals and the Ahoms. See chapter 7 for the details. The Sikh also chapter 8. And Mewar and Marwar. So you know that these two places, that is Mewar and Marwar, were under the rule of the the Rajputs of our country. So how was Humayun's relationship with Safavid Iran different from Akbar's? Did the annexation of Golconda and Bijapur in Aurangzeb's reign end hostilities in the Deccan? So all these questions have come up. We will see what is gunpowder was technology was brought to India for the warfare in the 14th century. Firearms were used for the first time in the regions such as Gujarat, Malwa and Deccan, and was used by Babur in early 16th century. Cannons were an important addition to the 16th century warfare. Babur used them effectively in the first battle of Panipat. So you can see the Mughal emperors, the major campaigns and the events. So when you talk about Babur, in 1526 to 1530, he was in India, and he in 1526 he defeated Ibrahim Lodi. He was the last Lodi ruler and his Afghan supporter at Panipat. He was invited by Ibrahim Lodi by Behlol Lodi, who was uncle of Ibrahim Lodi, and he had perceived that ancestors like Timur and all, that he will come plunder the country and then they will leave. But then this didn't happen. So Babur came to India and he settled here only. In 1527, he defeated Rana Sanga, the Rajput ruler, and his allies at Kanwa. Kanwa, that was in 1527. In 1528, he defeated the Rajput at Chanderi, established control over Agra and Delhi before his death. Then Humayun, 1530 to 1540, and then 1555 to 1556. Humayun divided his inheritance according to the will of his father. His brothers were each given a province. The ambition of his brother Mirza Kamran weakened Humayun's cause against Afghan competitor. Sher Khan defeated Humayun at Chausa in 1539 and at Kannauj in 1540. After the defeat in Kannauj, he had to flee to Iran to save himself. In Iran, Humayun received help from Safavid Shah. He recaptured Delhi in 1555 but died the next year after an accident in this building. So he ruled for 10 years, that is from 1530 to 1540. But then he had to run away to save himself, and Sher Shah had defeated him, and then again he came back in 1556. But then he survived only for a year and he died in 1556. So So in although he received a very warm welcome in Iran, the Safavid Shah, treated him very nicely. After Humayun, Akbar was the one who came to the power. Akbar was 13 years old when he became emperor. His reign can be divided into three periods, that is from 1556 to 1570. Akbar became independent of the regent Bairam Khan. Since he was very small when he ascended the throne, he was just 13 years old. And it is said that when he ascended the throne, it was not the condition was not very smooth. It was not a bed of roses for him. That means it was a very he had to deal very in a different way, because lot of people were there who thought that he was a small child and he could easily be defeated or the empire could be taken control of. So with that aim, when he ascended the throne, Bairam Khan was appointed as his regent. So as a regent, he was there from 1556 till 1570. Akbar became independent of the regent Bairam Khan and other members of his domestic staff. Military campaigns were launched against the Suris and other Afghans, against the neighboring kingdom of Malwa and Gondwana, and to suppress the revolt of his half-brother Mirza Hakim and the Uzbeks. In 1568, the capital of Chittor was seized, and in 1569, Ranthambore. So that is the time between 1556 to 1570, Akbar became independent and he declined the regency of, or he said that he is not going to accept the regency of Bairam Khan and neither his supporters. Military campaigns were launched against the Suris because he wanted to end the successors of Sher Shah Suri. Then his own half-brother's revolt of Mirza Hakim was also suppressed by him. In 1570 to 1585, military campaign in Gujarat were followed by campaigns in the east of Bihar, Bengal and Orissa. These campaigns were complicated by the 1579 to 1580 revolt in support of Mirza Hakim. The last one is 1585 to 1605. Expansion of Akbar's empire. Campaigns were launched in the northwest. Kandahar was seized from the Safavids. Kashmir was annexed, as also Kabul after the death of Mirza Hakim. Campaign to Deccan started, and Berar, Khandesh, and other parts of Ahmednagar were annexed. In the last years of his reign, Akbar was distracted by the rebellion of Prince Salim, the future Emperor Jahangir. With this, we will stop here, children. Please read the chapter. We will continue the chapter in the next class. Take care. Be safe at home. Thank you.